coming out with kids today. And for those who, how many people here for the first time? Well, yeah, we speak so violently. You ain't here for the first time, bro. In the back. Oh, you here in this spot for the first time? Oh, I think you've been here too. All right. How many? Give it up for Dr. Anderson in the building. How many people here from Baltimore, with Tubman City, what we call? Raise your hand. Give yourselves a big round of applause, Tubman City. And where else? Who else do we have in the building here today? What city?
PG County.
Give PG County a big round of applause. Anybody else? Taylor in the house? New York? No? Eastern Shore in the building. Give Eastern Shore a big round of applause. Family in the building. All right, we want a big family in here, y'all. Y'all know what we do with school violence, reality speech. We ask how the athletes feel. And as loud as you can, you say the spirit is strong, it's definitely strong. Can we do that? Get the spirit lifted here. Let's try it one time. How the athletes feel?
Spirit is strong, definitely strong.
One more time, how the athletes feel?
Spirit is strong, definitely strong.
All right, cool. We ain't gonna hold you long. We're gonna get right to the presentation for today. I just want to say,
is it Dr. on now?
Anderson,
yes,
okay. That we really appreciate Dr. Anderson. He's really been, you know, having some, give him a big round. Thank you. I have a lot of struggles with his health. You know what I mean? He's getting a little older. He's been out here speaking for years. And I called him to come speak, and he never turns me down. That's the reason why he's here today, because like I said, he never turns me down when it comes to coming to Baltimore here with us with Reality Speaks. And we appreciate that. We had to push the date back to today. And we said, look, I gotta come out there, and you know, so bear with us, you know what I'm saying? Some things he won't be able to do because, you know, he just, you know, his health won't allow him to do, but he's here with us, he's gonna talk to us, be patient. You know, a lot of our elders are getting a little older, we gotta be patient and get the wisdom and knowledge and information, all right? That cool?
Yes, sir.
All right, so without further ado, let's give a big round of applause. Big round of applause for Dr. Carl Anderson.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that much appreciated applause. And again, I'm delighted to be here with you. And you must, you know, there must be something very special about you all. You know that? Because this has been a horrendously negative year for me medically. I've gone through one damn series after another. And for me to come out of a hospital and say, I'm going up to Baltimore to speak to some black people, and I'm not even going to get paid to go. And I said, I'm just trying to regain my walk and balance again. I said, I must love you all, okay? And see, that's one thing I made to myself when I was a very young man in the South in North Carolina. And when I found out how badly black folk were being treated, and more importantly, that nobody, no ethnic group, no religious group, no gender groups, anybody gave a damn about black people. And they come into this country to compete with you. But your civil rights leaders and your so-called public officials and elected officials, even your minister was always saying, well, we're all together, we've got to be like, that's BS. You all in a competitive relationship struggling to survive. You've never had any friends or allies. Don't believe that crap anybody tells you. Don't believe, I don't care if it comes out of the mouth of a civil rights leader, public elected official, or a minister. Anybody tells you that you got to get along with everybody else, that is a lie. Do you know what a race is? What is a race? A race is a contest. It's a contest. Racism is a contest. You're competing to survive. And when I come up here to Baltimore, we used to be a 67% black city, and I see how this city is being gentrified. And you have no leadership, period, in this city. And it's for a very specific reason you don't have any leadership in here, because you don't own and control a damn thing. That's why you don't have a leadership. Whoever owns and controls the resources control the people in this city. You have no leaders in this city. I don't care if you got a mayor, city council, they ain't worth a quarter if they don't own and control any resources. And if they don't own the record, there's nothing they can do for you. And see, I've been preaching this sermon now ever since I first got in politics about 50, 60 years ago. Fighting for black folk, when I went with governors and presidents and ran campaigns for president, President Jimmy Carter, ran campaigns again with Bill Clinton. I was his deputy political strategist here in Maryland. I was the first black to ever run a campaign for a president. I was the first black to ever be appointed to the United States Department of Commerce as assistant member of a cabinet for the president. I was the only black that's been a chairman for economic development for governors. The only black that sat as over a property disposal program for the federal government, where my signature alone, I could give away any federal property to anybody I wanted to give it to just with my signature. No black in the history of this nation ever had that kind of authority. And I did it in many cases to get stuff for you all. Even dealing with people like Strom Thurmond. That's how, let me be more specific. In this, and because since Donald Trump is in power now, and he's now stacking the courts against you. He's stacking the federal courts against you by appointing federal judges. The deck is loaded. The dice are loaded. The cards are marked. The machines are rigged. You haven't got a snowball's chance in hell of being able to survive. And I don't know what the rest of black, I look around this room, all this extra space. Where in the world are black people in Baltimore? They should be here today. If I get out of my sick bed to come see you, where are they? And people said, Doctor, you got to be crazy going to see somebody. They don't even show up. You see, y'all are the strongest few you got in this city. I don't know where the rest of them are. But I keep telling blacks across the country, don't worry about having, you don't have to have all of them. Half our people need to go ahead and perish and get the hell off the earth. And I mean that. You all can quote me. I'm on TV every damn day. I remember I'd be on the Breakfast Club in about another week. Y'all, fine. I'll tell you straight up, half of them ain't worth a quarter. They're a total waste of time. They're nothing but an insult to the race, holding the black race down. Half of them making a big lot of money, running with balls, football, basketball, baseball, tennis ball, golf ball, singing, dancing, telling jokes, pretending they're having a ball and holding balls. It ain't worth a quarter. You have no leadership. Because in the real simple reason is because you don't own or control anything. And they put this pablum on you always about, well, you got civil rights. Civil rights ain't worth a quarter if you don't own and control, point one, and if you don't go back to the original intent of the civil rights laws. Everybody talks about civil rights. They're talking about it for everybody but you. The civil rights laws were put into effect in 1965 and 1866 were strictly and solely for black people. Why in the world would you sit in a city like this and let them use it for everybody but you? It's inexcusable, totally inexcusable. They keep pulling you about civil rights. Civil rights is a bad, a negative, a nothing, a zero, a zilch. Civil rights and I mean, social integration was designed to take you backwards. And it's done a very effective job. Most of you in here are not old enough to know that. See, you had, as black people in this country, you had more before the civil rights movement started, before social integration came. You had something decent. You have nothing now. And I don't want to get you upset now by being so negative, but that is a fact. I grew up in the days when we had something. It might not have been the best, but we had something. I grew up in the days when we had communities. You don't have any community. You haven't got not one single black community in the entire United States. You cannot be an effective power source without a community. You don't have any community in Baltimore. You have nothing. All you got a bunch of damn neighborhoods. That's right. A neighborhood is where you eat and sleep. A neighborhood is like a bucket with holes and water running in. You put some in it, it runs out. A community must have three elements to have a community. You must have a wholly independent economic structure. You must have a wholly independent economic numbers. That's one of the first elements to have a community. There's not one black neighborhood in Baltimore, in any city in the United States that has a community because they don't have any economies in there for black folk. In your economy, you must have ability to be able to produce products, services, goods, tax base, jobs, and opportunities for your own people. No black neighborhood in America can do it. How in the world are you going to compete in this city when you own and control nothing? Absolutely nothing. I bet you got a black elected official for the mayor, black city council, and black city in the state legislature. You should ask them, what are you doing for black folk? What are you doing for black folk? And do not let them run that BS on you, but well, we're doing this for everybody. No, it ain't worth a quarter for
Do not let people start talking about what they're doing for everybody. The minute they start talking about what they're doing for everybody, you get up and walk out. That's a game. That goes all the way back to the first constitution you had in this country. The first constitution was a constitution of the 1st through the 12th Amendment that everybody keeps talking about. We got constitutional rights. You don't have any constitutional rights as black people in America. They tried one time and they put a second constitution, which picked up after the 12th Constitutional Amendment left off. The 13th, 14th, and the 15th Amendment and the Civil Rights Law were strictly, solely put in effect for black people to reverse the Dred Scott decision of 1857, which says a black man, black people have no damn rights at all, no privileges, they are property, they're not citizens, they can own and control nothing. In a society where and here's an advantage, and that's in a society where what you own and control determines your rights and opportunities. That's why right now in Baltimore and all across America, you own and control one half of 1% of anything of value. Even though you make up about almost 13 or 14% of the population, you still own one half of one. You haven't got a snowball's chance. Unless you learn to start playing the game. You can't play in the game messing around with civil rights and social integration. You can't, and I'm talking a few minutes, you're wasting your time talking about political candidates. Ain't no political candidate gonna do anything for you all. No political party's gonna do anything for you all. That's why right now nobody's in this room but a few of you all. The rest have been snowballed, sandblasted, and brainwashed into always singing, I got plenty of nothing and nothing is plenty for me. That's why right now they sit right at home right now just as happy as a sissy in a CC camp. I'm serious. They're just as happy. I'm gonna watch the TV. I'm gonna watch TV and watch the football game. That's my team. How much you own? I don't, that ain't your damn team then. You see, I'm being honest with you now. We as black folk got some serious problems. And see, the only person I know in history, in my years, in the 80 years, that ever tried to reverse these things by myself was been me. I've been the lone wolf for 50 or 60 years. I disagreed with Martin Luther King. I disagreed with Jesse, Al, all of them. Junior Bunn, my friend Junior Bunn, Andy, all these are friends of mine. I said, you're taking black folk the wrong way. Even when the marches out to my, you're going the wrong way. Black folk don't need to be no damn marching. They said, well, Dr. Allen, we're marching for, we're gonna get something for, what are you gonna get? We're gonna get equal opportunity for them. You're gonna get what for them? We're gonna get some equal opportunity. Now, anybody in this room that got past the third grade would know that if you don't have equal resources, there is no opportunities. How in the world can I have an equal opportunity to fly a plane if I don't have a damn plane? But see, that came back during the 1930s when they started putting this stuff about, that time they called it universality on black folk. What you black folk need, you know, this came from the civil rights leaders, your black newspapers and your black ministers. Because you see, the black folk doing slavery, they might not have been that bright because they were denied an education. It was against the law to teach a black person to read and write during slavery. Anybody getting caught teaching a black person to read and write during slavery, it would cost you $100, 39 lashes, and $100 in fines. Never teach a black person to read and write. You know why? Because white folk knew you're in a competitive society. That's what racism is, you're in a contest. White folk are not stupid. They're gonna let you educate black folk. At the same time, you're gonna have this Negro working for 11 hours a day with no pay for the rest of his life. And you're gonna come on and try to educate him. White folk are not dumb. Nobody's gonna educate you. They'll teach you to read and write. And that went on for 360 years. And see, but black folk might not have been the smartest people. They couldn't read and write. But guess what? Some of your grandparents were still smart enough to outbeat the system. And that's why they set a record for the smartest people on earth. See, all during slavery, when slavery ended in 1865, guess what? That 96% of all the black people in America could not read and write. 96% of all black people in America could not read and write. But between 1866 and let's say, let's go up with a period now, between 1866 and let's say about up to about 1896, guess what? Black people set an achievement record educationally that nobody ever beat around the world. Don't let people tell you how stupid you are. Those black folk that came out of slavery with no education, inability to read and write, couldn't count, but they had enough sense to say, what I'm gonna do is get myself some land. So between 1865 and about 1920, those black folk that's gonna be dumb and stupid and ugly and next to a field animal, three-fifths of a human being, guess what they did? They acquired over 20 million acres of land. Couldn't read and write, but they got smart. They said, land is the key for us. Just like in the Bible, when Moses was trying to find a new land, parent land for black, for Moses' people, the followers, it said you must have land. And they would call it the promised land. And those blacks acquired 20 million acres of land. But guess what? The same time what happened, is white folks during that same period of time brought in all these white Europeans from around the world to America. They brought over 30 million of them in. And they classified them as immigrants. And see, in this country, immigrants have special rights over you all. Because you see, when they were bringing those 30 million immigrants into this country, you were classified as property, not citizens. Three-fifths of a human being equal to a field animal. Immigrants have special status in this country that you don't have because they're immigrants. And the Constitution was based on that. That's why the first law that was passed after the Constitution was ratified in 1789, the first thing in the next year, in 1790, was to pass the first immigration nationalization law that says anybody coming to this country that is not black is entitled to full privileges and everything that we have in this society. And it starts with land, which means everybody that's coming to this country. The minute you set foot on the ground, you're entitled to 650 acres of free land. 650 acres of free land. And under the Homesteading Act, you get another 150 acres. What they call for the Homesteading Act. And for the head of the household, you can pick up another 150 acres for every slave you own. So white folk begin to acquire land, territory. And that's why George Washington, what you all call the father of your country, first thing he did is said, well, we're gonna play this game based on the Constitution. And it's gonna be a race base. It's a race base. Race is a contest. Now we got these black folk locked down and nailed to the floor. They can't do anything. But immigrants can come in, they can benefit. And we're gonna give them, so George Washington said, when we start giving out this land, let's start with me. And George Washington said, give me 100,000 acres of free land. Thomas Jefferson, that you all read about in your school books, he said, well, they're good. If you're gonna give George Washington 100,000, give me 100,000 acres of free land. That's what Thomas Jefferson said. Then Patrick Henry, would you read the textbooks talking about give me liberty, give me a death? He also said, hell, give me some free land. And he got 65,000 acres of free land. Railroads were starting up. Every road, we had 11 railroads starting up. Each railroad was able to pick up. They picked up over 24 million acres of free land. They picked up 6 miles of free land on both sides of the railroad all the way across the United States. 6 miles of land. If the railroad ran from Washington, D.C. to San Diego, they had 6 miles of free land on both sides of it to get it at their own time. Everybody was making out with land. And so finally, when the Europeans came in after the Civil War, they had a big land rush. About another 25 to 30 million whites came in from Europe, went out to the Mississippi River, and they're going to explore the West. And in 24 hours, they picked up over 2 million acres of free land. So in the final analysis, whites then picked up over 2 billion, with a B now, White people in America got over 2 billion acres of free land without spending a penny for it. They didn't pay for it. They got, picked it up free. And guess what? And in that land, not only did they get the value of the land, but they got wealth that's in that land. The timber, the gold, the silver, the chrome, the bauxite, the magnesium, the gas, and the oil. They got diamond. Well, they got everything. Gold was in that land. So by the time the Civil War ended, guess what? White folks then had control of 99% of all the wealth in this nation. And here comes poor blacks coming out, your ancestors coming out talking about, we want 40 acres and a mule. And that, you know where that came from? That came because a few white radical Republicans had said that we have more, if we're going to set black folk free, there's only two things black folk in America and in Baltimore can be. They're going to be continue to be slaves or they're going to be free. But to be free, they must minimally have 40 acres and a mule. That's where that came from. Minimal. You cannot set these black folk, you cannot turn almost 4.5 to 5 million black folk free with nothing. No land, no tools, no wealth, no clothes, no history, no education, no family, no unit, no mules, no guns, no weapons, no clothing, no religion, no organizations, no leadership. You cannot do that to them. But they did it. And those black folks went across the country trying to figure out how to survive. And white folks in the legislature said, the white rednecks, conservatives said, well, they're gonna, these black folks have to root, hog root or die. A root hog was the word they use it. We don't care about them. These black folks spread out all over Baltimore and around the country. No jobs, no money, no house. They start sleeping in alleys, on the streets, in basements and houses, and because nobody cared about them. And so, but the whites, on the other hand, had the wealth. Where'd the wealth come from? They got it from slavery. That's where they got the wealth from. And the whole point of the United States Constitution says what we're going to do, we're going to maldistribute in the, across this nation 100% of all this nation's land, resources, materials, wealth, businesses, income, and controls of all levels of government into the hands of the dominant white society to make sure these Negroes can never, never, never economically compete. That's why you only had 0.5% or 1%. It has not changed. What in the world are the people in Baltimore talking about? It hasn't changed. You're still in the exact same place. You own and control nothing in Baltimore. And what I was going to show you today, just so you can't see, I know you can't see it. I broke it out to make sure that you get, at least you get some, thank you, good Curtis. You see this? I know you can't see it too well, but I'll try to point it out to you. I broke it out to show you why you haven't got a snowball's chance in Baltimore unless you learn how to play these games I'm going to tell you about today. And so I know you can't see all over it, but let me turn it like this. And what I got here is I go around. The blue, that is white wealth in America. You see the blue in that blue? That is white wealth in America. Going down to the bottom right here where my fingers are, not my fingers are, listen to that, bad English. See where my finger is? That is black folks' wealth. Right here on the yellow part, that is Hispanic wealth. The green is others. Now, you see what you got? Everybody got more wealth in America than black folk. You see why you haven't got a snowball's chance? That means everything in the United States, from New York to San Diego, is owned and controlled by whites. They own all the industries and businesses. When I come to the city, why is that you don't own anything? You see that? That's the problem. It's what you own and control that determines your opportunities in this city and in this country. And you can struggle all day long, work as hard as you want to, but if you don't get some wealth and power, resources, you're not going any place. That's why nothing has changed for our people since slavery. And one day, sometime this spring, maybe by the summer, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to come back to based on a request, an invitation from Jabari or African World Books, I'm gonna come back and tell you exactly, very specifically, some of the business and people in this city that has stifled and kept you in a ditch and they're gonna keep you there as long as they can. I'm gonna tell you one of the biggest business in this city, what they've done to deprive you of the opportunity to learn how to compete. Because had they not intervened and done some things, you right now, you could have hundreds of thousands of businesses right now in the seafood business, the water business. Right now, you could have a major control of the hemp industry, producing all kinds of products, from CBD oil to everything else. You see, in doing slavery, hemp was a prime product during slavery. Black folk raised hemp. Everything on the plantation was made out of hemp. The clothing, the paper, everything. The clothing even the black folks know in war was made out of hemp. Everything's made out of hemp. That was all set up for you all. But one big business that wiped you all out in this city. Make sure you have none of those businesses. And see, and also in the whole thing like the bottled water business, it was set up for you all in this city. All of you, most of you could have gone into the bottled water businesses. Right now, there was a process set up where you all could have gotten access to 56 million gallons of free water to put into bottles. But a major business and you kill that for you. And I won't tell you the name of it until I come back this summer. And I'll name the company and tell you what it is. At that point in time, I'll be like Donald Trump was saying. Instead of saying lock them up, you start saying close them down. Because right now you're being deprived of the opportunity to do all these kind of things. So what I'm going to get, I'm going to give you my speech and I'll tell you the things you're not start doing in this city. You've been deprived of access to resources, wealth, and power. What you got to do now is go back and forget about all that stuff they taught you about civil rights, all that stuff they taught you about social integration. That's an absolute waste of time. In this city, you all need to figure out how to organize. I said this last time I was here. Organize and figure out how to own and control resources. The key for you all right now is resource ownership. Resource ownership. What do you own? What do you own? That's the key. If you can't get hold of anything and own anything, you're out of business. You're through. And that's what the Donald Trump thing, they're going to shut you down. They're going to shut you out pretty soon. It's what you own and control. It's called resource. Get resources. Now, why resources? Because let me give you a line. When you got resources, then you're set then to do something. When you got, you're set to be just the opposite of what you are now. And two things in the world. You got consumers, you got producers. Right now, you're 100% consumers. You don't produce a darn thing except sweat. When you watch them on TV, they're all running with a ball, sweating, playing gym, hitting golf balls, dancing, singing, all out sweating. All they produce is sweat. Nobody's buying sweat. You got to learn how to buy, produce products and services and goods that people want. All this stuff. Well, look at so he's playing with so and so. He makes $1 million. That's sweat producing. They are being managed. They're being paid by someone else. Somebody else owns them. And that's another update form of slavery. They're on a payroll. I want you all to say, no. Dr. L said, we want resources. Once you get resources, then you're in business. See, then from that, you can start doing what, man? Producing what? Products. You understand? Excuse me a second. You can start producing products. You start producing products then. And you'll be thinking about when you leave today, think about what products you're going to produce. You can produce the same amount of products that whites or folks are producing that you're buying. Quit buying products from other people. Once you get resources, you start producing products where you can buy from yourself and from your own people. And that's the basis now I'm telling you about to start learning how to practice group economics. You must learn how to produce group power, group economics by producing. Get resources, then you produce. And once you started producing over here, what comes follows that? You started getting income. You started getting income. And once you get income, you build more products and services, and that manifests itself into what? Wealth. You saw that big green thing I just showed you with that? You got to get wealth. Wealth is the key to your surviving in this nation and in the world. Right now, if I were to take all the blacks in America, all the blacks in the Caribbean, all the blacks in South America, all the blacks in Africa, and put them together, guess what? They could make up 24% of the world's population, but guess what? They still only control what? One half of 1%. I got blacks right now dying just to get back to, we're going back to Africa. For what? So we can make it in Africa. You ain't gonna make it any better there than y'all here. You got a better chance of making it in America than any place else. if you learn how to play the game. The game means understanding the nature of things, start to come together playing as a team. We're going to start playing as a team. Racism is a team sport. And when people started coming to you talking about, well, Dr. Anderson, he's a racist, and he did this and that. You said, well, he said he's supposed to be. That's what white folk wanted. They're going to practice racism. But you cannot keep talking about equality in a race-based society. You don't want any equality. People said, Dr. Anderson, what do y'all want? We said equal opportunity. We want equality, then we want freedom. All that comes with owning and controlling. Okay? And that's the game. Then once you get those products, we're going to start going into business. And I'm going to tell you, I give you a lot of ideas. And in my books, the Black Powernomics, the Empowerment Plan, I identify all those key businesses that you can go into. Go into business in Powernomics principle and dominate wherever you dominate in population and spending patterns. Where dominate in population and spending patterns. Now, what things do you dominate in population? Baltimore, you should be owning controlling this whole city. This is your city. You should be owning controlling it. You should not. What they've done now is made you a guest, and everybody else is making out over you. That's the first thing. In terms of consumer patterns, Black folk right now, you eat. As an example. You eat, guess what, 3 to 4 times more seafood than anybody else in this nation. You go to any restaurant selling seafood, Black folk are going to be the primary eaters in there. White people love things that are red meat with blood running out. They want red meat, something they can shoot, buzzard, anything. I don't care. Rabbit, purse, squire, deer, anything. And that's what they want to go deer, and that's what they want to kill. Black folk want seafood. So if you are the major consumers of seafood, you should be dominating, controlling seafood. I mean, you should have seafood restaurants all over this place. Right. Not buying from anybody else. Anybody else selling seafood, just right past them. Walk past them. You should be owning and buying only from Black-owned seafood restaurants. Mm-hmm. Period. Not Red Lobster, anything else. It'd be yours. Right. Second thing, you dominate right now in leather, for instance. Black folk right now buy more leather than anybody else in the country. You should have leather outlets. You should be trying to build an industry that sells raised leather, sells leather, processed leather. It's easy. And most of the leather now that you're getting is coming in either from the Far East or from Italy. Fine leather comes in from Italy. Rough leather comes in from China, Japan. You should start your own industry. All you do is come together, start your business, and then build industries. Industries are key. You're the only people on earth that have never owned industries. Because when the industrial revolution went through Europe, you were slaves. When the industrial revolution ran through America, you were slaves in America. You got to build some industries and do it vertically. You got to have an industry here, and then as it goes up, you produce as an industry, then you warehouse, wholesale, retail, then you become consumers. You understand what I'm saying? It goes straight up. You build your own businesses. This guy builds it to the bottom. This person buys from him. Next person buys from him all the way up the ladder. That's what the other group's going to do. That's why these immigrants coming into the country, that's what they're doing. They're taking over industries. They're going to take over all these. They know which industries to take over. They're going to go straight to your community. They're not going to go to the white community. They're going to your community. When Arabs come in this community, in Black City, they're going to try to control everything from the grocery chain, food markets, liquor stores, party stores, discount stores, gas stations, they're going to control all of those in every Black city in America. That's why in Detroit, Michigan, you got about 146 gas stations. Arabs now own 144 of them. In a Black city, it's 92% Blacks. Blacks own 2 gas stations out of 146 in a major Black city. I don't know Baltimore. I bet you right now Arabs control all the darn gas stations in this city for you. They go vertical. They come to this country, they're going to go vertical. They know who's in. They know where to go to get them. When the Asians come to this country, they're going to go vertical. They say, well, we're going to control, we're going to go to every Black neighborhood. We're going to control Black hair care. We're going to control Black hair care, Black products, Black cosmetics. We're going to control the wigs and everything else. And we're going to set up nail polish shops and everything else they can name for it. They're going to do the, they're going to name it and control it so you'll spend the money and give it to them. In every community, it's going to do it all across America. And what you're doing, what we do, is we're enriching them. They come here poor and we enrich them. We have enriched everybody on earth but other black people. And we got blacks all across America say, I'm not buying for no black person. I'm not going to make him rich. Why not? Why don't you? Poor people can't help poor people. Help enrich these other blacks. And tell them, so look, I'm going to help, I'm going to buy from you first. But after you get up and get strong enough, you turn around trying to help the rest of these black folk build it up. For instance, let's take liquor. Black folk right now consume about 44% of all the Scotch liquor in America. But you don't produce not one drop of it. I can go on and on. But theater tickets, black folks spend about 90%, used to be about 47% of the theater tickets. But we don't own any movie theaters. We used to. We used to have a chain of theaters across America. Lincoln and Lafayette theaters in every black city. We had our own theaters. But we gave them up so we can go to the white theaters. Because we lost our sense of communities. And that hurt us. I grew up in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Give me a signal in about 10 minutes, 15 minutes, I'm going to sit down, okay? Okay, in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. We understood it. My family was one of the families that the only black family in America that owned a bus company. In Winston-Salem, North Carolina, we had a bus company called a Safe Bus Company. You go to your computer and look it up anytime you want to. Safe Bus Company. Our Safe Bus Company not only serviced our black neighborhoods, it serviced white neighborhoods too. We had over 500 buses. 500. We didn't have two or three buses. We had 500 buses that took care of the white neighborhoods and the black neighborhoods. You know what will kill off our bus company? Who can guess what killed it off? Who said that? They was right on top. He got it figured out. That's exactly right. Integration killed off our bus company. You know why? Because the black folk said, we shouldn't be sitting on the black or back of white buses. We want to sit on the front of them. And so when Rosa Parks said, I don't want to give up my seat. Black folk had a big march down in Alabama. So they can now, what they want to do is integrate the buses. When that movement came, they said, we don't want to own the buses. All we want to do is just sit on them. Now, I'm be honest. That is funny. That's stupid, but it's funny, isn't it? We just want to
integrate them. And so the whole civil rights movement said is moving horizontally. We're going to move from the back of the bus to the front of the bus. And what I'm telling y'all, always go vertical. You should have been saying, now who owns the bus? Who collect the money, the materials, the mechanics, the management? Go up. Same thing with the water fountain. Black. So I'm not going to set this black water fountain. I'm going to walk over to the white fountain. I'm not going to go to school at a black school. I'm going to go across and go to a white school. I don't want to live in the ghetto with my own people. I want to move to the suburbs. They always want to go horizontal. And white folk love that. They love that. They love, they know that they, if they're up over you, they say, I don't worry about those suckers. They're going to go that back and forth like this. They ain't going up. They ain't going up. They're going to move out of the ghetto, go and move to the suburbs. And guess what? Then after they move to the suburbs, we're going to move to the exurbs. They're following us. And once we move to the exurb and they come out there, we're going to double back and go back downtown to the inner city and regentrify it and take it over and leave their butts out there so the new ghettos will be in the suburbs. They trick us every time because our people don't read and they don't listen and they don't do. That's why I wrote all my books strictly, solely for you all, to teach you all these tricks that they're up to. That's why this book sounds like five books called The Library Pack. All these things that you want to know about race matters in those books. So nobody can trick you. It hurts me to my heart to go around this world and watch everybody tricking black folk. And I go back to what Malcolm X once said. Malcolm X says, if you want to keep a secret, put it in a book, a black person will never find it. And I said, I'm going to put all of my secrets in books. I got my time. So what I want to do now, let me show you. Two things I want to do now is I'm going to show you what's happening in this city as an example. This was an article that appeared in the Washington Post. You know what it's about? Here's a major article here talking about what? how Hispanics saved American cities. You see that? Right here. How Hispanics saved, and Hispanics are taking credit for saving all these black cities, including Baltimore. And you, and I look around and you all are participating up here. Why would your city council, in a city that owns nothing but black folk, why would you put in something like about $2 or $3 million to put up a special Hispanic community and put in a theater so they can have a place to meet and do things? Charity, racism, you must track the same. Take care of your own first. Now I'm gonna tell you as a pilot that if we lose cabin pressure at night or at 30,000 feet in the daytime, we lose cabin pressure and oxygen, a mask will fall down over the panel. When the mask fall down, put the mask on yourself first. You have been brainwashed as a people to always want to save everybody but yourselves. Every time there's a march, black folks are leading the march, your civil rights leaders. We got to save the poor. We got to save the physically handicapped. We got to save Hispanics. We got to save Asians. We got to save gays. And what they do, they conflate these things. They show it. Well, Dr. Anderson, those people, I mean, they're equal to black folk. No, they're not equal to black folk. You are special, exceptional people. They weren't even in the country when you were being enslaved. And you start talking about, well, how about the gays? Gays, some of the biggest slave owners in America were gays. Gays never did anything for black folk. As a matter of fact, the Two Sisters restaurant right now in New Orleans, one of the oldest and biggest restaurants in New Orleans, was by two biggest lesbians doing slavery. They still got it. As a matter of fact, the president of the United States, right before Abraham Lincoln, was a gay. Anybody, because you have not seen in the boats coming across this world bringing in for picking cotton, bringing in gays to pick cotton. They only went after you. Nobody enslaved Hispanics. Nobody enslaved Arabs, Asians, Filipinos. They enslaved you. That's why I went to President Carter. They called me one day about 1970, somewhere in 70, what day it was then. They called me and said, Dr. Anderson, we Office of Managing Budget to set up this new criteria for what makes up minorities, so people who can get special preferential treatment. And then we got a whole list, and we want you to participate and help identify them. I said, like what? Right now, rather than just only blacks, we're going to expand that and put everybody else in there. We're going to put in, instead of just trying to figure out, you keep talking about doing something for black folk, we got to do something for everybody. I said, that's the same trick you used during slavery. That's why it's in the Constitution. They used it when the Constitution said all the people, they knew they weren't talking about black folk, you were enslaved. They always use these very broad, ambiguous terms to make sure that you neutralize anything that should go for black folk, you neutralize it. Put everybody in the pot, that way blacks will get nothing. And he said, and that, therefore, we're going to include in the minority program, we're going to set up a program called Minorities. We'll put everybody in there. Include, we're going to throw in white women. White women are not a minority, they're a majority. But we're going to throw them in the pot so they can compete with black folk. And I know they will strip black folk. I said, you know they will strip black folk. Because, see, a white woman going into a minority program, she could be the white man's daughter, wife, sister, or mother. He can get four times the benefits you can get by throwing white women into as a minority. But they didn't got away with it. Not one black leader raised Cain about it in the country. They went for it. And they set up a program called Chapter 9 in the country. So now there were any benefits that go into the community. Women now, they call it Section 9. You see that? They're talking about for girls and stuff. That's what that's for, Chapter 9. So they can now. And that was put in there by a white congressman from Virginia and a white senator from Louisiana. They put it in there as a joke. But now when I was over education for the state of Florida, and I'm gonna check and see what happened to all the money going into Florida. Out of 6 or 7 counties, asked them, how are you gonna spend the money now in race matters? Who are you gonna spend it on? Blacks or women? All 6 or 7 counties said they're gonna spend their money on women's issues. Right. Because you see, they mix things up. just this week now, they, what they're talking about down in Williamsburg, down in Colonial Williamstown down there, was about slavery. But guess what they're going to do now? They now set up special curriculums.
They put in gays and transsexuals into it. And so the endangered species in this society pretty soon is going to be the black man. You're in danger. If you're heterosexual, you're in danger. That's why they're all these magazines now. They're going to start off talking about putting gay men wearing dresses and all this stuff. Every actor in Hollywood, right, and every man, they want him to wear a dress to make a movie wearing a dress. This is intentionally done to neutralize any benefits going to black folk. And I'm not against gays. I'm not against anybody. I'm not against Asians or Arabs or Hispanics. I'm not against anybody. But I am for black folk. There's a difference being for something than against it. I love black folk and I'm not everybody. I'm not going to let, as long as I live, I'm not going to let people continue to beat up on them. Even some of our people are dumb enough to volunteer to be beat up on. I'm not going to let them do it and get away with it. And so now, so the whole issue now is that they're going to conflate these things so that black folk will get nothing. And in that regard, now we're going to come up on a new election. And here's Donald Trump going around now. And what he said when he ran for office in 2016 in politics, he told you all this. He said, nobody's going to support you off anything. He said what I've been telling you for the longest. In 50 years of writing with presidents and governors around the country and over education for the state of Florida for 7 years, I told black folks, nobody's going to support you. They're going to take everything that should go to you and mix it all together so you get nothing. If you want to make sure somebody in the family gets nothing, you only got one child, throw another 6 or 7 in and see what you get. That's what they're doing to it, conflating it, make sure that you get nothing. And Donald Trump said, I got a copy of his recent speech down in Atlanta last about a week or so ago, where he's now saying, I'm going to chase in the black vote. He said, I can trick these blacks and I can get reelected. They won't know the difference. He said, you need to vote for me because you all ain't got a damn thing to lose. Y'all understand that? He said, ain't nobody going to support doing anything for you all because you all don't demand a damn thing. And you can keep electing leaders that won't demand anything for you. And so what he said here is, that, what in the hell do you have to lose for vote for me, even though I'm not going to do a damn thing for you? But neither is the Democratic Party, neither is the Republican Party. Neither one going to do anything for you, not in the history of the nation. And what our people don't understand is that they vote, well, I'm a Democrat. The Democrats were the first people to start enslaving you. The Democratic Party had you enslaved from the beginning of the country in 1789 all the way up to 1866. The Democratic Party was a group that was enslaving you. And you see, when Donald Trump talks about those red states that is his base, that 25%, those red states of the South, those are the Confederate states, the same states that enslaved you. They still got you locked in box. So the Democratic Party was your enslaver up until 1865, 1866. At that point in time when blacks broke free, they said, well those Democrats have been enslaving us, killing us, they've lynched and murdered us. They've slaughtered hundreds of thousands of black folk have been lynched, castrated, hung up. And so black folks said, we're going to go to the Republican Party. So blacks ran joined the Republican Party in 1865 and 1866. And he stayed with the Republican Party, and guess what happened to him? They got Jim Crow re-enslaved through Jim Crow segregation and got locked in box again. He says, and that lasted up until about the late 1940s. Blacks were re-enslaved by the Republican Party. Then by the early 1950s, they said, we're going to get out of this Republican Party because they've been mistreating us. And where are they going to go? We're going to run back across the street and join the Democratic Party. And when they ran back across the street to join the Democratic Party, who had enslaved them earlier for 360 years, the rednecks, conservative, what they called the Dixiecrats, they said, we're going to leave the Democratic Party. We're going to now go and join the Republican Party. That's how the Republican Party became the conservatives. Same rednecks had you enslaved before. Our people didn't know that. They just went for it. And so now they say, well, we're going to do this. Well, Dr. Hans, what should we do since neither party, no presidential candidate is going to do anything for us? Not, no Democratic Party or Republican Party will do anything for us. I told you in my book, Black Labor, White Wealth, and the Black History Reader, get out of the parties. You don't need the parties. Why do you keep joining up with all these other parties? Ain't no candidate gonna do anything for you. I don't care how many debates they have. Don't sit there like a fool watching the debate. Now, one is gonna mention, if I get elected, here's what I'm gonna do for black folk. None of them are gonna say that. And you should be saying, then based on what Anderson's saying in all his books, we go back to the primary purpose of politics. What is the primary purpose of politics? It's to decide who's gonna get what out of life, period. Politics, as you know it today, never came into existence until the 1500s. It came in, it's called a politique in France, which means based on a very simple premise of quid pro quo. Something for something, one hand washes the other. You take care of me, I take care of you. You vote me in the office, I owe you. And yet I found all these years, no black folk ever want to practice quid pro quo. You don't demand anything from a candidate. You don't demand anything from the Democratic Party. You don't demand a damn thing from the Republican Party. All you want to do is the satisfaction of voting. And they take you for granted because they think you're stupid. When I was in Washington, all the time, they would come out and tell me they would think you were a joke. The doctor asked, you kill yourself trying to take care of black folk. We think black folk are a darn joke. Nobody's that dumb to keep voting for something and getting nothing. Why would you go down to a grocery store and get a whole basket of food? You know, and say, well, everybody else is getting a basket of food, but I don't need one. I'm gonna just go to the cashier and give him my money. What are you getting for your money? I don't need anything. I don't want anything. And see, and Jews figured that out a long time ago. That's why in 1935 they wrote a song. Got George Gershwin, one of the big Jewish songwriters. He wrote a play called Porgy and Bess. And black folks still sing that song. He wrote that specifically where Porgy is downtown, but in the black neighborhood. Bess is up on a balcony. He's singing to her, I've got plenty of nothing, and nothing is plenty for us. Why would you let people trick you? And if you're going to vote for somebody, don't vote until you demand and contract saying, if we vote for you to get our vote as a black vote, here's what we want. Stipulate it. I want this, 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 and this. If you don't do it, you get nothing from me. So blacks tell me, so doctor, well, that means we'd be suppressing the black vote. No, I'm not asking you to suppress the black vote. I'm telling you to arrest the black vote. Arrest the black vote and redirect it when it produces products, services, and goods for you and benefits for you. Quit giving your vote away without getting anything in return. Go to all your elected officials. They come to Baltimore and say, hey, you put something on the table, we'll deal. If they won't do that, then what should you do? You pull out of the Democratic Party, you pull away from the Republican Party, and you create what? Your own black party. And they tell us that we're going to vote as a black party. 100% strong. We got 46 million black folk in America. We're going to create a black party. We're not going to run into candidates. Running a candidate is a waste of time. If you got money and wealth and resources to get your own businesses, you don't need to run. That's why mafia, when I was with the police department and organized crime stuff, the mafia, organized crime does not vote. They're not going to vote. You know why? They're going to buy every damn politician they get their hands on. They got the money. You go around and vote and get nothing, they don't vote and get everything. When you get your little businesses set up, I'm telling you about, and industry set up, you start buying every politician. And now those politicians you can't buy, you rent or lease them. And may use them for your benefits. So you set up your Democratic Party, you set up a black party. You tell every politician in the Democratic Party and Republican Party that we, as a black cross of board, we're going to vote as a solid block, 46 million strong. And we'll vote for whoever promised the most to give the black folk. If you come to us talking about what you're going to do for minorities, and poor folk, people of color, and African Americans or Polish Americans, no, we ain't voting for you. You're not an African American. I keep telling you that in politics, the dumbest thing you can do, when I was heading up dispensing programs and assistant secretary, when I was chairing the economic development for governors, the worst thing you can do is shoot yourself in the head, come and say, well, I'm an African American. No, you're not. Because whites got you beat when you do that. You make yourself an ethnic group. You're not an ethnic group. Every black in America that's the descendants of slaves, the minute they put you on a boat out of Africa,
They begin to de-Africanize you, disengage you from Africa. They cut out all your Africanness by shipping you to this country. Once they got you here, they used to have a process that ran 3 to 6 months called a seasoning process to make sure that they stripped you of everything that pertained to Africa. You had no more appearance. They made sure that you didn't get any letters or Christmas cards from Africa. You didn't know anybody in Africa. They stripped all that out of you and made you very special people. And that's where your power is. Your power is your uniqueness, your specialness. It say we are special people. We are not African American. We are native black Americans. That makes, because once you put that word African in front of it, whites say, well, if you're an African American, you're no different from the Asian Americans or the Chinese Americans. No. Don't put me in that category. They weren't even here when I was up here being slaved and Jim Crow and segregated and killed and slaughtered. They were in this country. They're not equal to me. You're special. And most importantly, once you put that African word in front of your name, you know what happens? You then qualify everybody in this country to be equal to you. Human beings originated out of Africa, then migrated around the world. Y'all understand what I'm saying? Then once they come to America, what are they then? African American. Anybody coming from Europe is what? An African American. When he gets here, he becomes an African American. People coming out of Philippines, once he comes to America, he's now an African American. Because all human beings came out of Africa. And they get over on you that way. And most importantly, what you do, I'm telling you, in the political arenas, I haven't been in all the back rooms. Don't listen to what these other people talk about, these ethnocentric, they're two-sex-centric. Because what white folks in the back room say, I would love for black folk to call themselves an African American. Because that way I don't owe him anything. Once he says an African American side or not of a Native American, I don't owe him now. And that lets him off the hook. And that's why he come up and say, if you black folk are not happy, go back to where? To Africa. Don't let them put you in that bag. Say, no, I'm not going any place. I was here before you came here as whites. And the rule is those who come first stay here, those who come last leave first. You tell them to go back to Europe. And see, whites have gotten smart. That's why white folk right now in America, you're not hearing white folk coming from Portugal, Arabs, French, Germany, Russia, call themselves a European American. They ain't that dumb. Because they know you can put the trick on them. They call themselves what? White Americans. And what do our people say? I'm not black. I hate that color. I'm not black. I'm an African American. And see, even when I was a kid, people could come to this country. I mean, not people could come to this country, but this country gave people coming in from Africa or from the Caribbean, they gave them special rights over local blacks. When I was a kid, people that wanted to come downtown and go to a white hotel, a white restaurant, they were blacks, you know what they would do? They'd wrap a blanket around their head or a baby napkin around their head or something like that, a diaper. Get them a pair of boots and throw a kente cloth across their shoulder and put on something that looks real freakish and walk down to the hotel and say, I want to come in. Wife said, what? And they said, all my minutia, but the ho ya. And they could get in. White folk, it didn't bother white folk. You know why? Because he wasn't an in, you know what I'm saying? He could get by. You could get by if you pretend that you're not an in, or what I call a native black American. But I'm for native black Americans. That's my people. And you tell people ask me all the time, well, Dr. Anderson, I don't see anything special about blackness. It is special. It's because what I'm telling you is that it's not just your color. When I call you native black Americans, it's not just your color. You know what it is? It's your history. It's your honor. It's this country's indebtedness to you. It's your rights and privileges. You are special people. You're the only people that's been mistreated, maltreated to come to this country. Nobody has enslaved and Jim Crow segregated, mistreated people for 460 years but you. Nobody else. Don't try to get away from it by trying to hide, sneak past. Because you do a disservice to yourself and you hurt all the rest of the blacks in the country. When you hear white folk love to put it in the paper. A truck just ran over a black person or an African American. We got to stop them from running over minorities. Y'all understand that game? Now, maybe you missed it. See, they shift this little game on you. A truck just hit, they never going to say black, therefore we owe blacks. They never say, a truck just ran over a black man, let's quit running over black people. They ain't going to do that. They're going to shift it to African America because you let them off the hook.
And so I want you to start going before all these political bodies and going for all your elected officials. No. Don't call us what we are. We are natives here. We were here before anybody else. People say, well, how about American Indians? No, you were here before the American Indians. They call themselves American Indians. That's why they changed themselves or call themselves Native. They're not natives. They came across the Bering Straits about 5,000 or 6,000 years ago. They were Asians. They came across the Bering Straits, came into Canada, came down from Canada down into the north, down in the north United States, and then to the southwest, and interbred with people who are already there. Those are called Fulsome people. Those people were black people from Africa. They've been here 16,000 years before the Asians came across the Bering Straits and came in this country. And then when those Asians came into that country, they interbred with those black folk. That's why it created a new breed called Indians. That's why Indians don't have yellow skin and slant eyes. They have round eyes and brown skin because they interbred with black folk. You got to go back and claim your exceptionality. You're the only people that were denied the rights, the food. You're the only people denied your humanity. You're the only people denied the right to vote. You're the only people denied to be in government. You're the only people denied an education. You're the only people denied your humanity. You're the only people denied a religion. I can go on and on. You are special, exceptional people. You are native black people, period, in this country. You are supposed to be ahead of everybody. Nobody can be equated to you. You tell them, I don't want any equality. I got all kind of politicians running around saying, but Dr. Anderson, you need to know that all people have contributed equally to the development of this country. That's a lie. Asians, Arabs, Hispanics, and rest of the people weren't even in the country when black folk were being enslaved. How are they going to be equal to you? That's the biggest lie they've ever been told. Black folk are the people who, black laborers, that built the country. You built the bridges, the roads, the highways. You built the buildings, all these big government buildings, the schools and everything. You were the labor class. And the reason you don't have any wealth, in conclusion, is because your wealth was your labor. Black slaves, labor. That was their wealth. And the reason you're poor, as I told you with that chart I just showed you, the reason you don't have any wealth is because your wealth is your labor. When white folks stole your labor during slavery, they stole what? Your wealth. And that's why whites right now only control almost 99% of all everything of value and importance in their society. 87% of that wealth is frozen and locked into their society and their communities in stocks, bonds, capital, businesses, everything. They got it locked down. Only 13% is up for grabs. I want you all to go after that 13%. Go after that 13%. And in this city, they started building all these communities for all these immigrants. You tell them, you can come in if you want, we're not against you, but you're not going to be equal to black folk. You're not going to be over us, and all you'll be equal to us. We are special people. We demand respect and appreciation. We want special programs for us. Programs to recognize, appreciate, and reparate us for what we've contributed to the development of this nation. Nobody else. And don't let them put you down and talk about how equal you are. No. You're not equal. They cannot be equal to you. They have not done anything to justify being equal. You are special. Hold your head high and keep yourself high in the sky and be as black as you want to be. I love you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. That's my team. That's my team. Okay. Now, do me a favor, y'all. Go out there and start correcting some of these civil rights leaders and these black elected officials and even our ministers. Tell them, no more. We are special. And there's nobody in this country like us. We are special people. We built this country. We're entitled to reparation, appreciation, and recognition. And reparation, we're not going to take anything less. And mean it, okay? And so you can get our vote, but you must put something on the table that's coming specifically and solely to black folk. If it don't talk about it's going to minorities and poor folk and people of color and poverty, poor people, and to gays, Hispanics, transsexuals, midgets, humpback, lesbian, anybody, one-eyed, bald-headed, anything, strictly for black folk, okay? I love you, and now wait, and I'm gonna leave you shortly.
Give it up again for Dr. Claude.
Thank you all. Okay. Before I leave, okay. Two things I want to mention to you. First of all, when you hear me talk about our nativeness,
Always remember, we must also be linked up with all of our other black sisters and brothers around the world. Just that when you prioritize yourself first, because you, just like Jews put their core in Israel, that's not where their real core is in America. That Jews in America control what happened with Jews all around the world. I want blacks, native blacks in America control and look out for and protect blacks all around the world. You got the power base. So stay linked with blacks in Africa, blacks with blacks in the Caribbean, and blacks in America. Second thing is that if you made any recordings today, please do not put that on AOL, because that's injurious to me and the companies out there, because whites always want to know what you're up to and what you're doing. Don't tell them what I said to you all. Don't put it up on a well. Somehow people love to tell every damn thing. As soon as they hear it, they'll run out and tell every damn body. So you cannot keep it a secret. If you recorded something, I don't like you to record, do not put it, post it up on the websites. If you got it at home, fine, but do not post it, because right now they would love to try to stop me or block me from being able to contact you all in this country and around the world. Don't participate and be in cooperation with them in doing that. I love you and respect you. Remember those two things. Stay linked up with all black people around the world. We are linked, but prioritize getting your base strong in America. Then we can help Africa. I head up trade missions to Africa. We can help Africans once we get strong in this country. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Hold on. One second. This is the elder in the room.
I thought of using the name indigenous black American.
Right, okay, good. That's right, that's what he's talking about.
So let's close our fam with the Harambes. And like I said, 2020, we want to show Dr. Claude Anderson all his work is not in vain. We want to start making some things happen, all right? You want to do that?
Yes, sir.
All right, we got to rebuild the spirit of this town, man. You know what I mean? All over the country. So let's close out with our Harambes. We do it 7 times, and the 7th time, we hold it as long as we can. All right, 1, 2, 3. Harambe! 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 Thanks for coming out. Dr. Claude's gonna be on our side for a few minutes. If you wanna get your books, whatever else you wanna do, you can come on the other side. We'll have a vendors on the other side. Thank you for coming out. Stay tuned. Like I said, we have some stuff coming up next week. You want to be a part of the panel.
Thank you. And God bless you.